Spirit gave me the dream that plays for Father. And I had a dream about my father. Actually, I had the dream about my father on the day that the dead fell. But I decided I wasn't going to play till after the 21st. Show you how clever I am. And didn't check the date. And 6:25 fell on the 21st. You know? It was a clear picture of my father. You know. The last time I had a dream, I was talking to him. 2:79 fell. Talking to the dead. Your spirit will hook up. If you have, the more knowledge you have, the more your spirit will unwind your messages in symbological dreams that are relevant to your life. Your grandmama's name, your aunt's sister's nickname. I guess, you know, the kind of food she used to fix, stuff like that. This one brother who needed $25,000 for whatever. He didn't tell me what he needed for. His mother's cancer. His mother passed. Now, I don't know if it was true or not. He said she came back over, you know, crossed over. And some spiritual beings have the power to do that. They can come back from the other side at will, if they have the power and the grace to do so. And gave him a number straight. And he called it for $25,000. Tax-free. Mama. Mama sent the baby stuff. The strong violent bind between the Cancerian son and Mama. A very strong tie. And sometimes it didn't help him, but this time it proved to be quite a beneficial thing. But I'm saying that there is something very definite about dreams in relationship to numbers. All dreams are not numerically interpretable for hitting the lottery, okay? So, you know, some dreams are. When 789 fell, like last month, this month, I stopped playing. I played New York number. And I started to lay down. Now, usually, I get dream interpretives after I'm half sleep, almost sleep. This one started before I could get my head on the pillow, you know? A group of black folks moving around, and then suddenly this white face comes up in the middle of all them, looking left and right, you know? I should have known something was up, but my mind was not on the plane. Bam, 789 the next day in New York, place for white men.
Yeah.
So, your dreams can be quite vivid, particularly those with the sevens. Pay attention to your mind, all of you, first of all, not just those with sevens in the chart, but black folks, period. Believe your own mind. We just got through talking, my sister and I want to mention this. There is a problem on the subconscious level of the African's collective mind. He is, even in his awareness of his Afrocentricity, its value and its power and its potency, is still about the business of sabotaging his new America. We're still refusing to acknowledge one another, to patronize each other. It's a failure syndrome we have learned. Some of it directly, most of it indirectly through our parents and the very shabby display of failing symptoms that we see in our world, our children, our parents, the drug problem, the drinking problem, the fighting stuff. The subconscious is learning how to undermine our success. You must be aware of this. Thought is very powerful. Not just your thought. Thought is very powerful. Okay. The wrong thought can take up the energy of the right thought. If you're not dealing with positive thinking, if you're not dealing with thoughts of light and of truth and of knowledge and of power, the old saying, as it may seem, certainly isn't old, an idle mind is the devil's workshop. Believe me, it is still true. If you're not doing something with your mind, somebody is. If you're not mastering yourself, you believe somebody's mastering you. area we have not dealt with, you know, in our culture. It is our own mind and the power we have inherited from our ancestors. Because we got this attitude about our ancestors.
It wasn't about nothing.
I've heard that. And that's very unfortunate. That's very unfortunate. You can't erase yesterday's black man and black family. You're erasing yourself. You're the extension of yesterday's black man, black woman, and black family. That's why we're here. We don't leave the past. That's the root of the present and the possibilities of the future. We need to understand that. Very, very important. How many of you good American Negroes brought your Bible today? We're making ourselves into Moors, but because we speak English and think from a Eurocentric point of view, in Eurocentric symbology, which gives precedence to the European image, when you think in English, when you speak in English, you can't help it. There are a handful of words in the American dictionary that complement the ethnocentricity of being black. And black is not one of them. All of the wonderful, wondrous words were in reference to someone who does not even exist, a white man. There is no such thing as a white man and a white woman. White is in reference to light. That's all it is in reference. We gave them the light, you know. And it's deep. Language is really very powerful. Very, very powerful. Very seductive. I watched something I thought was over in America a couple of weeks ago. The bus got very crowded. And the first two seats right behind the bus driver are very small seats. This little, small, petite, light-skinned Negro woman was sitting there. And there was several women standing, and men too. She was sitting next to a black woman. This cracker got on the bus. I mean, you know, I'm saying cracker because that's what he looked like in the stereotypic of the redneck and the red nose and you know, the flaming eyes of fear. This woman got up and she bowed her head. She saw him coming. This happened. Catch this scene. She gets up out of her seat. The white man, her seat. I couldn't believe it, man. I couldn't believe it. 1993. The slave mentality is still in the back of our heads, okay? We have to unlearn that. Unlearn that. That's why it's important to obtain the three missing keys of the African culture in America. Identity, self-knowledge, and self-revelation. Those are the three missing keys. That's what we are here doing. And it's important that you get into this book, the Bible. You know, this dude, Koresh, won't go away for a while. You know, he didn't tainted and polluted everything holy with his ignorant demonic butt. And one of them is that the fact that he was going to interpret the seven seals.
Incorrect.
Well, thank goodness he didn't get a chance to show that dumb stuff. I don't know what he was about, you know, but it could be enough to confuse the issue. You know, and as the mindset is in this culture, you know, I'm in my head, I still cannot see a white boy walking up to me, telling me, "I am the Christ."
Good.
Well, if you don't get out by me. Well, as I thought about it, Imam Issa said, you know, in the 70s, that he was Jesus. You know? And he's teaching Arabic. So he's from the house of Yehuda, the house of Judah. And brother's got power.
No doubt about it. Brother has power.
And he's still saying he's the Lamb. You know, even though they've gone from Islam to the old Hebrew, the Nubian.
So, I mean, there's plenty of them out there claiming this, you know,
and that's fine. But if a brother doesn't come up and say to you, look, I am God, and so are you, he'll let me get the hell out of your face.
That's right,
you know? Yeah. If it ain't about you, it ain't about nothing. You know, that's the finest premise I can offer. If they're talking about God, they got to be talking about you. Mm-hmm. It ain't about bow down and scrape and scram. It's about arise, you know. It's about raise up in 1993. Putting on G-O-D is what we're doing here in this session of classwork. And I always mention, I think, at least I should always mention, John chapter 10, 31 to 36. That's my piece of evidence found in the scriptures that the American Negro, chicken-eating, biscuit-sucking, Reverend Shoestring is not dealing with, you know. And I'm going to get on until we get it right, you know. You got me, biscuit? I'm on you. I love you, but I'm on you, brother. Yeah, he needs to be stimulated, you know. He needs to be stimulated. We don't need any more ignorant Negro folks falling a hunky to death. You know, I mean, I thought we would have learned something behind Jones. And here you look up, there's a brother sitting back there listening to the white boy doing yes, the boss. Worse, yes, the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Damn.
Let's get on here to Revelations. I'm going to start at the beginning because I made a mistake. I proceeded with the assumption that we knew what Revelations was about, and then went on beyond that and started dealing with it when we dealt with the 12 powers of man. But that's too big of an assumption. There's too much paranoia and mysticism around the book of Revelation to the point where even preachers are afraid to deal with it in their pulpit. Essentially, the problem of the African preacher is that he does not have access to his Afrocentricity, his African education, which would automatically have granted him a knowledge of symbology, which his ancestors invented. With symbology, one opens the book of Revelation, and as well as the other codex inscriptus, the code written in to the scriptures and the dictionary, and other esoteric or hidden material. It is a part of the Masonic lore, which is ancient Moorish knowledge and practice. With the keys of symbology, we're able to do wonders with all of the mysticism that even today, the black preacher is still not dealing quite well with. So we want to make sure we know what we're talking about. I don't want you sitting here. In fact, I thought about doing it, about reading something stupid and just getting y'all to say amen. You know, because you're supposed to check me out, particularly behind stuff like Koresh, when it was on that brother's mind. You know? So if I say something, if I quote something, I should be able to verify. But the major theme is this. Remember, I'm not talking about me. I'm talking about you. I'm talking about the God that is you. That's the theme. When somebody gets away from that one, that's when your eyebrow should go up. You know, when they start doing Jesus out there and how wonderful Jesus is and how wonderful Muhammad Rasulullah is, and wait a minute, you know, they're going away from man, know thyself, what your ancient ancestors again left you as a legacy, self-knowledge.
is the knowledge that, that we are lacking and perishing because we are lacking. Not just knowledge, yes, sir.
So is it so that everything that Jesus did and anybody before him or after him, we all can do, each and every one of
that's
us?
That's right. That's what we want to come to the realization of. And that realization is a part of your spiritual experience. You can read that. Someone can explain that. Someone can teach that. But what you want to do is realize that in your consciousness. The idea of knowing that you are a God is to become a God. Prove me herewith, saith the Lord. Not the Lord out there somewhere, the Lord within. The Lord is law of the universe. He who embodies the law of the universe is the Lord of the universe, whoever he or she is. Okay, Revelation chapter 1, let's start right there and deal with what we're talking about here. Someone who has a Bible want to read Revelations 1:4. Just read 1:4. Who's got it? He's got it. Speak up, young lady. And a big Bible too, thank you. Go ahead. Bless your heart.
1:4. John to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace may be
unto you. Stop right there. Read that again.
John to the seven churches which are in Asia.
All right. Right there. Where you stop. Not the seven churches in Atlanta, Georgia. Not the seven churches in New York or Mississippi. The seven churches that are in Asia. Now, where is Asia?
To the east.
What does Asia mean? That's the question the student should ask.
What does Asia mean?
Thank you. And Elijah should have given a definition for that because he put it up there as a comparative to that of all of the other terminologies about the planet and made the division between what he was teaching, what Novodrawali was teaching. Though they were teaching the same thing. But he said, remember, he's the one who said we were Asiatics out loud. Durali is the first one who said we were Asiatics of Moorish descent. But he didn't define Asia either. And we've allowed our scholars and our teachers and our preachers to get away with this labeling of the African without defining the words. We've allowed it. That what God has made is what Asia is given in its metaphysical definitive. Doesn't mean it doesn't have another meaning, because it probably does. God makes not flesh. Mama makes flesh. Okay. God makes ideas. The creator's creation is the mental creation. Mama created all the rest. Mama Earth and Mama Mama. Okay. It makes that body in 9 months. All right. The reason I'm pointing that out, because what we want to realize is that the entire book of Revelations is symbolical and spiritual. It is not about the outside. It is about the inner. The inner universe, that the universe is mental, that we are mental, that God is mental, that the word church is in reference to something mental, that every symbol in the Bible is in reference to something mental. That's important. Otherwise, the Jehovah's Witness can yank you right out there in the world, and show you all these revelations. They've been waiting for this revelation since 1925. And he started early, 1914. He had one
people, and folks supposed to be moving away, and Jesus was coming back, and all, you know, I mean, you know, because they were dealing with the exterior. And most fundamentalists still are. And they're going to argue with you. And you're going to meet them. They're going to come and knock on your door. You know, they almost got me the other day. I peeped out the window and saw me.
Pull the shade down.
No, I don't pull the shade down no more. You know. Yeah. Just put on something black and open the door and stand there. What's up? You don't get too much swag when you look black. Okay. That what God has made. Then we go on. I got it marked here. I'm going to skip a little bit. But first of all, once again, read the book of Revelation carefully. Make these underlinements, because I'm going to deal with the keys so that the chapters will make sense and the symbology will make sense. Okay. Okay, go on, young lady. Start there again, four, and okay. Read there, four and five at this time.
John to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you, and peace from which is, and which was, and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us, and washed us from our sins in his own blood.
Okay. I think the only other symbol there that we're going to be dealing with is the seven spirits. He read the seven spirits. Okay. There are, let me do this here just to give you a very sound picture of something quite interesting here about this idea of seven and how much this book encompassed it. There are seven seals, seven trumpets, seven vials or bowls, seven churches, seven candlesticks, seven stars, seven peals of thunder, seven angels. Plenty of sevens. Seven is the vibration or the number of completion. In the Metaphysical Dictionary, Fillmore gives a little light dab. He didn't deal too much with the chakras. He kind of stayed away from that, but he every now and then would drop a little light on it. You know, he was aware of it, there's no doubt about it. But some stuff he kept for himself, as many mystics often do. And he was a legitimate mystic, I would think. Seven, metaphysics. The number representing fullness in the world of phenomena. Seven always refers to the divine law of perfection, or the divine nature of man. That is your number, your ethnocentric vibration. Four, six, six, nine. Somebody add that up. Four, three, nine. Somebody add that up.
Seven.
Not just seven, that's a 25 seven. And that's a 16 seven. Numerology. Seven is the perfect number on the physical plane, on one dimension. Even the European physiologist and biochemist is confessing that you have the highest developed physical form on planet Earth. Even he's admitting that. Seven is also the vibration of power. Seven is also the vibration of mystical power. Mystical inquiry. Spiritual aggressiveness. As a word, the curiosity to ask the question why, rather than yes or false. Very important when the Reverend is
elucidating and pontificating to get his amen. Oh, is that right, Reverend? Well, can I get amen? No, wait a minute. Let's turn to John chapter whatever and deal with it. That's it. That'll be number vibration 7, doing that. If he or she does not have the courage to do it outwardly, he or she will be doing that in his or her mind. Mm-hmm. We'll be able to help it. That's how 7 thinks, that they want to know the truth. Not what somebody says, do you believe my brother? Yes. That ain't what Jesus taught. Jesus didn't ask folks to believe the truth. He said, know the truth. And the truth would set you free. Know is knowledge. Know is not only knowledge, but know is on what?
No ledge.
On the ledge, the level. That's what knowledge is. When you're on the consciousness level of knowing, that is when you have knowledge. If you don't have that level, all you got is information. Pure knowledge comes directly from your soul itself, through your intuitive faculty, your other spiritual faculties. Pure knowledge, accurate knowledge. Paul is accredited with making this statement, having the form of godliness, but not according to accurate knowledge. Very appropriate theme. Every Negro minister on Sunday should be jumping up and down shouting that one out and dealing with that one every Sunday, you know. Boring his congregation to death with that one. You're perfect and you don't know you're perfect. You're God and you don't know you're God. Somebody get that devil off of there, you know. I mean, that's probably what he would get first, you know. Because most black folks are so seduced to servitude. They find it very difficult to imagine the fact that they are God. Even though, and I mean, the proof is, I've shown it to black folks in the Bible, the book that they swear by, you know, and will kill for and die for. And one brother down in the Dumas, I told him, read it and looked at it. That ain't what that means. He couldn't believe it. It's interesting. Because there's something back here that says, you ain't about nothing, you ain't worth nothing, you ain't nothing. I'll get busy there and throw a ball, you'll throw you away. I'll throw you out your own head. It's really deep. Really deep. Okay, let's get back in. Here's a very interesting one. It's not directly relevant to the seven seals, but verse 7, chapter 1. Who else has a Bible they want to read? Just read verse 7 there. In Revelations 1. Nobody else got a Bible? Go ahead, sister. Go ahead and read. You got them.
Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen.
Okay, now I'm going to read that this American translation. You got King James here. That's obvious. Okay. Same verse. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him. Quite a difference, isn't it? Jesus is coming back. The Bible says he's coming.
Yeah,
that's what they're putting on folks. Got folks walking around scared to death. Yeah, because look up and Jesus might be standing on downtown there, Martha Square. That's where they at down there every Monday morning, you know. Preaching away, you know, every eye shall see him. That's spiritual, not physical, in spirit. The Christ you want to see, let me rush us up a little bit here, is the one that you are. That's the one you want to see, okay? Yeah, I mean, so it's nice to see somebody else raised up, you know. And my brother, he's got his robe on and all this stuff, you know.
it's fine, it's good. Can't it? New World Testament all somewhere. Mm-hmm. I don't want it.
New World. So what is the cloud?
Spirit. Whenever you see the word cloud, it represents spirit. Whenever you see the word white robe, it represents spiritual power of light. Remember, white means light. That's all it means, okay? Ain't no white folks. So we get out from between the unsolvable problem of opposites. You can't solve a war between black people and white people. That's duality. Duality ain't going nowhere. It will be going on when you leave. And if you don't leave, right, you're coming right back down here in duality to battle the good against the evil. Where the fat will be talking about the skinny. You see, it'll be popular to be fat. It's unpopular to be skinny when y'all get back down here. Okay? Duality. You can't stop it. We are the original human being. Any other human beings came from our genetic coding. That is not opposite. That's chronology. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Who's last? The first shall be last. And the last shall be first. Yes, sir?
So what then will be the difference in the thinking between white and
when?
Black? When?
What will be the difference?
The psyche, yeah.
What should be?
What is the difference? What should be? Yeah, let me ask that.
The important point of view is to have the correct point of view about yourself. That's the correct thinking. That's all you're responsible for.
So if we're the original, then, yes, and they are, they came from us in
no, they came from the Oriental. They look more like them than they do like us. But the Oriental looks more like us.
So my question is, what is the difference in the thinking? Or is there a difference?
In their thinking? First of all, they're not thinking with very much melanin.
Right.
And many of them don't even have any. You know, because there are a lot of European albinos, you know, who have almost no melanin in their entire physiological makeup. And we think and feel with this substance. We don't even know how to view life without thinking from a melocentric point of view, with feelings, you see, to understand what it means to have melanin, to be passionate, to be concerned, to feel something for someone, to intuit, to sense brotherhood, sisterhood, friendship, kindness, forgiveness. And another reason why we know Jesus was black, he forgave everybody. There better be a white boy baby say, "Oh, my daddy gonna get you." It is the substance that makes you more human, this melanin in your blood, in your brain, as to whether you're light brown skin, high yellow, you still got it. You still hooked up. Okay. Your sense of rhythm differs from every other ethnocentric group. To appreciate that, beyond that of pride, which means absolutely nothing, it is to appreciate the universe functions by rhythm, that life exists because of rhythm. And you're attached to the same rhythmic pattern of the universe. 2, 4, 6, 8. Instead of 1, 3, 5, 7. Which is a count, but it's the opposite count. What does that mean? Well, meditate on it and discover some wonderful things about yourself that you've been taking for granted all these years. And believe me, meditating on melanin is worthy of your spiritual meditation. There are some things your God would like to reveal to you about the essence of life, about this black very important word in its original language. There is power in being and having this substance. It's what produces everything else. Out of the darkness cometh the light. Okay, let's go on. We ain't getting very far, are we? Oh, yes, we are. I'm going to start jumping and skipping here. Okay. Verse 9, let me read that. Same chapter. John, your brother, and fellow partaker in the tribulation and kingdom and perseverance which are in Jesus, was on the island called Patmos. In the King James, you have the word isle right here.
Right.
Okay. The Isle of Patmos. Erasing. Really don't need to draw this. Nervous system, and I'm going to abbreviate it, the medulla oblongata is the Isle of Patmos. That's where he was. Okay. In the east. All right. Where's the east, Isaac? Say it out loud, say it here. Now, some folks don't know that. The east is the front of your body. That's the east. The north is the top of your head. The south is the bottom of your feet. The west is your back. He was on the Isle Patmos. The east is within. The west is without. That's where you are, buried in a shallow grave in the east. All right.
Could you go through that again?
What part?
What you just said.
The direction. The top of the head is the north. Are you writing it down? All right, because don't you ask me this next week when I can you stand up and
forward. Yeah, if I get the answer today, I won't ask you.
All right, dear. Very good. The east?
First, could you read back over the scripture again and then go back through it?
What I'm explaining, first of all, is Patmos. Okay, the key here is where John was. Okay? Because the preacher is saying he was in prison. Somewhere in Asia Minor, okay, we're all in prison. We are buried in a shallow grave in the east with him. Patmos is the nervous system and the medulla oblongata. That's where you go to when you get laid out, slain in the spirit, when you're in the Lord's day. Or on the Lord's day in the spirit. You move into the nervous system, in the vertebrae. You go to church, to seven churches, your vertebrae. We're going to get to that in a minute. What I was just bringing in is the fact of direction. It is important in things spiritual. That Revelations is not talking about the outside world. It's talking about the inner world. The things that God has made. God made things from the spiritual to the mental. And nature duplicated it in the physical. Mama is nature. Mater, matter. Mater, mother, same word. The origin of all things. Zero is mater, is mother. The essence, black, is zero. None of the European numerologists bring that to light in their delineation of their literatures of the nine numbers and zero. One of them even suggested that you don't wear black. Real phobic, huh?
That's all he wears.
Yeah, they're wearing it for a different reason.
What reason is that? How come they're wearing it?
We get distracted. No, don't do that. Stay on your side of divinity.
Leave those others alone.
Stay on your side. Okay. Is that clear enough now about where you are in relationship to where John was in Patmos, the Isle of Patmos? He's supposed to have been in jail. Okay, well, that's okay. That's fine. The symbology still works quite well. But the point is, it's inside, it's symbolical. As we will find out here. Verse 11. Write in a book what you see and send it to the seven churches. Then he gives the names of the seven churches. I won't read that. And verse 12. And I turned to see the voice that was speaking with me. And having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. I was supposed to have my chart up here, and I don't have it. I left it at home. I should have left it here. The seven golden lampstands are the seven segments of the physical vertebrae. From the medulla oblongata to the coccygeal vertebrae, the one that turns at the end of your butte, those are the lampstands. All right. Write it down so you can check me out.
All right. What's that other one? At the bottom of
the coccygeal.
Coccygeal.
C-O-C-Y.
C-O-C-X-Y.
C-E-A-L. Okay. And in the middle of the lampstands, one like a son of man. Let's say like the son of God. One like a son of man. Clothed in a robe reaching to the feet and girded across his breast with a golden girdle. Behold, John saw himself in his spiritual body. Scared him. He was waking up. Been blessed. This is John's revelation.
You know, Jesus said Jesus wrote a book. The book was revelation.
Well, that's all exterior. John represents the spiritual candidate who has the power of love. That's how you get your chakras open. With love. In your heart. You can't force those open. You force a few other doors open, but oh boy, don't do that. Now I'm gonna deal with this. I wasn't gonna deal with this because we made this assumption. I didn't wear my t-shirt today. I got three copies of it. Jesus is a black man, and on the bottom of it is a quote that I'm going to read here. This is one, Revelations 1:14. And his head and his hair were white like wool, like snow, and his eyes were like a flame of fire, and his feet were like burnished bronze. That's at the bottom of this t-shirt with Jesus painted as a black man. That is not what that means. That Jesus was a black man. that though he most certainly was a black man, that particular verse is not in relationship to his woolly type hair, which I rest assured he had. But wool represents spiritual power, wisdom. When it's white, it's what?
Right.
All right, now remember that now. So when you see the word anywhere in the Bible, W-H-I-T, it's in reference to light. The white robe is in reference to the aura of the light. That's what the robe represents when you get it. That you either have the light or you're going to get the light if you keep your robe on. And don't let Satan take it off because he's busy trying to snatch it off. Okay.
And
light. Yes, it is the aura. It represents the aura here as a symbol. Yes.
When you were talking about how white means what now? How it
means light. Okay. That's all it means.
Okay. Then why in Leviticus when it describes the cursing of Canaan and the lepers as having like white skin and white hair?
Well, okay.
You found a
symbolism of
the. Yeah, it says white like lamb was his hair.
Right.
Then it also refers to the lepers as having white thin hair.
Okay. Well, I don't know whose translation it is. What we're talking about is the metaphysical level of scriptures. I don't want to try to jump over there because I haven't even dealt with that, but I'm familiar with the area about leprosy. The loss of melanin is something more than physical. It most certainly is something spiritual that is lost, but I haven't even given that any consideration. What I'm trying to do is yank your attention off the physical and put it on the spiritual. That's what I'm trying to do. Just the fact that Jesus is given the name Amen tells you he was a black man. That's an Egyptian African name. Title for a king and a god. That alone is evidence enough. It was one of his most illustrious names. One of his new names, that of Amen. Okay. Stay on the spiritual. Stay in the symbolism of life. You get yanked out there. Okay. Whatever is true where? Within. What's the law of correspondence? As within? All right, okay. We're talking about the laws. And with these laws, we're able to understand the knowledge of the Son of God. As soon as you get out there, you get into his story. We missed the point. Okay. And his feet were like burnished bronze, the energy of the astral body. When it has been caused to glow in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of many waters, the sound of Amen, Aum, or Om. The sound of many waters. Since we're talking about Amen, let's look at what it means. It has an exoteric and an esoteric meaning, as everything does. Brother, you pulled me out here on Front Street here. I got to deal with some of this. Same word. Isaiah 45:15. O Lord, thou most surely art a God who hides himself. Amen. The hidden one. The hidden God. In its syllabic breakdown, it is Am, the ancient word for the word of God. It is one of the names of God. The word name means what, Isaac? Got you sleep good, didn't you?
Yeah. This sister here. Yes.
The nature of something.
Speak up so they hear. I know it.
The nature of something.
All right. Name means nature. That's the key for unlocking the knowledge of the Son of God. Name means nature. Whatever the name is, it will tell you about your own divine nature, as your name will tell you something about your human nature. Okay? I'm glad I'm doing this because, like I said, I'm making these assumptions and going, grabbing these big symbols and dropping them out here, you know, and boom. Something wrong with that, brother. So, let's just take it a little bit at a time. So we know what we're talking about, and we know what we're doing. So we can know what we expect. That's what's important. You know, not for me to sound heavy, brother, to threw a wrench out there on me. I got to deal with it. I got to go check him out now. See, if I come back here next Saturday, have you hooked up, there, brother? Thanks a lot. You know, I appreciate a challenge. I appreciate it. I really do. I don't even want to know everything. Believe me, I don't. But that is the Creator's job. I don't want to handle it. Yeah, I just want enough to raise, so I can take on that title, G-O-D, and do what I'm supposed to do. And get the hell off of here and go somewhere else. But they got it going on. They got it going on down here, believe me. They got it going on down here. But it is a challenge that it will strengthen you. Okay. Okay, I didn't deal with the church that represents the heart chakra. That's the one we dealt with last Saturday on the hot tub. The heart chakra, which corresponds to the astrological sign of Leo. And I just kind of politely brushed over that. The throat chakra is Sardis, the Church of Sardis, which is, can I pass it on me? It's the fifth chakra. So turn to 229. Actually, Revelations 3:1. The type of rabbi of his message to Sardis, the church is dead, yet having you believing. This is Schofield's fundamentalism here. Okay, the church of Sardis. Remembering that the church is in Asia, is within. I'm going to read the metaphysical meaning of Sardis here from John Charles Fillmore's book here. That is one of the few tools available in dealing with a comparative study of the chakras and scriptures. The metaphysical school of Fillmore is based essentially on the 12 glands of the body. But every now and then he would drop a few nuggets here and there dealing with the chakras that are in the etheric body. Whereas the glands are in the physical body. So we've gone further in. R-D, I got a mark here. Sardis, precious stone, carnelian, sardonyx, sard,
Prince of Joy, a city, the capital of ancient Lydia, and the site of one of the seven churches to which John wrote. Metaphysically, the riches of power, precious stone. Also, joyous dominion, Prince of Joy, a prince belonging to the ruling family. Those are the meanings of the concept Sardis. I'm supposed to have my chart here. I don't have the chart. Let me see here. Give you an idea what I'm talking about here. Because we're going to keep running into a very important word or words that, again, are misconstrued. Now, as I mentioned last, Vishuddha, the heart chakra, the pictures, the symbols of the Hindi school are not necessary to open your own heart chakras. The fact that they are highly colored and decorated and dramatically presented gives us a significance of their valuableness. That's what the word, and this word, makes reference to, and to try to keep it in line with this will help you as you study and experience the meaning of this word spiritually. The precious stones. Yeah, as I mentioned, I think last Saturday or Sunday, that's why they took this concept and why they call themselves by the names of precious stones. Rubenstein, Goldberg, Diamond, Pearlman, Silver. That's an occult order. On the negative side, it's an awful occult order. there is a legitimate side of it, where those that are really in search of God. There are some Europeans who are really looking for God. But then there are those who are claiming everything down here because they have the knowledge of the things down here. There aren't any African metallurgists. There aren't any Africans who cut diamonds. Do you know one? Didn't think so. A very well-kept African trade. How to cut a diamond. The quality of pearls. The brother Alan comes and says, check the gold out, brother, check the gold out. You know nothing about no gold, silver, nothing. You know, he's selling. He thought he'd rip somebody off, the white boy ripped him off. But the concept, the idea of precious stones is to be understood. You have those stones within you. They are a part of your spiritual makeup. You have gold and silver in your brain. It's a part of your spiritual chemistry. It flows into your physical chemistry. That's why they are important. Not for the things that they can buy, but because it is a part of your higher or highest nature. It's what we're trying to get to. And why Jesus says, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven, and all these other things shall be granted to you, because you'll be in tune with the law of attraction that will attract your good, riches, honor, and glory. That's what grace is. Things just get better when you raise up higher. Helps you to drop the fretting and the worry that gets you desperate and end up closing this up as you get cunning. Up here, I get some of that money. You know, I got to get some paper, bro. Give me some paper, right? Okay.
Next thing you know, he got some paper. Okay. Yeah, right. About 8 or 9 different sheets. And I put him on all kinds of paper. Okay. Okay, let me jump back here. What time is it? Because I got some dynamite for you here.
15 after.
Huh?
15 after 7.
Is it 15 after 7?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, wait. We're going to, for those who are here for the first time, we're going to meditate. And we're going to another level in our meditation. Okay. Well, let me see what else I want to include in these 15 few minutes here. Okay. The throat chakra is here. The power of the spoken word is the gland at the back of the tongue. Now, I didn't explain that in the first 12 weeks. Nobody called me on it or anything. I kept talking about the throat chakra, and everybody just said content, as I mentioned the gland. This ripped y'all off. Anyway, they interconnect. The power of the throat chakra, Vishuddha, which this writer says means pure, and it doesn't. It means praiser, Yahuda. It's where the word Yahuda comes from, Vishuddha. The Sanskrit language is the root of what is called the Hebrew language. So, like Yahshua is Parusha. Okay, you know, just to point out. An academic fact. This center here gives you the power of the spoken word. It is always open. If you can talk, then you know it's open. But the power only trickles in as you work with the techniques that open the centers. The more power will come through. So it isn't just a matter of thought word, imagined word, but also the power of the spoken word. That you see something that you want or are supposed to have or is going to come to you as it comes in a dream, in a vision. And then down here, you take your wonderful lips and talk it away. Okay? When you speak with power. The concept horses represents the power of the spoken word in the Bible. Philip, the lover of horses, is what Philip means in the old Latin language. He's the disciple assigned to the spiritual center, the power of spoken word. Very important because we are an oral people. So when you condemn the system with a dress up behind them back out there selling it for $3 to get a bump, you're condemning yourself. When you talk about the brother who's over there acting a fool, you're talking about yourself. If you wonder how come bad things happen to good folks, because good folks keep talking about bad things. They keep decreeing and declaring and proclaiming them in their world. Is that clear about what you are saying? About the principle of mind, whatever the mind conceives and believes, the mind will achieve, not can, as Napoleon Hill said. Whatever is conceived in your mind is born in your mind. Conception is birth. It already exists. When you can see it, it's real. Okay. Now, if you want it, give thanks. If you don't, start erasing it. In other words, if you see somebody snatching your purse, Venus, no, wait a minute, that's not going to happen in my life, not in my world. No one can touch what God has given me. No one can touch this temple. God dwells here. And keep on stepping with your purple on, of course, for protection. decree and declare today, not next week when you get to be God, next month, next year. Today, you're already God. Am I making myself clear? If you wonder why you don't have your millions,
I just want enough to pay the rent. That's all I need is this.
I hear you praying.
If I could just get, some brother said, man, if I could just get coffee there, I'd be cool. I mean, yeah, brother, get the coffee. Praise the Lord, alhamdulillah. You know, Grace Boy's got a little cup of coffee. Well, that's okay. But you don't stop there. Up here. The psychological assumption. Automatically provides the means to fulfill the dream design. Whatever you see yourself doing, having, beholding, it automatically begins to happen in divine mind. If you can feel it, sense it, see it, you've created it on the mental plane. It's about to happen. Then let it happen. If it's good, deny it if it's negative. The law works both ways. And that's what Job is saying. All the very things that I feared the most have come upon me. He created that stuff. I fear that he would lose everything he had, that he would get sick, that his wife would die. That he, oh, yeah. That's how powerful your mind is. We live in the world that we create on the mental plane. Yes?
What's the Job story? More test God on Job or Job on himself?
Job's Lord is law. Whenever you see the word in the Old Testament, L-O-R-D, that's the law. Not a person. You're on the outside when you start dealing with persons. Stay inside on the mental plane with the laws of the universe. I am the Lord, doing both good and evil. Who is that? That's the law of duality. It's not going to change. The master is not dealing with left and right, up and down. He's dealing with be ye perfect. On top. Okay? This book here is important for those of you who don't have it. Keep reading this. Oh, all of these principles are in the scriptures because the scripture is structured on the seven laws of the universe, wrapped up in story form, allegories, symbolisms, parables. No man can serve two masters. The law of duality. You can't serve fat and skinny. You can't be tall and short. You can't be rich and poor. If you're going to heal, you can't see sickness. The meta physician does not see what the physician sees. The physician sees the problem. Metaphysician sees the perfect man, the perfect woman, and works from that premise to restore that which already is. You have to stay there, otherwise you get back out in duality and things ain't going to make no sense. You know, we almost got caught up. Everybody's sitting waiting. See what they do to Rodney. I'm sitting around waiting. And I had to deal with this stuff, you know, because I'm sitting around waiting too, you know, because we got locked into this collective consciousness thing, you know. He became our symbol. I mean, Rodney basically is a knucklehead, not a hero. He became a symbol of an ill in our consciousness. And what's wrong with this ugly country. And everybody says, hallelujah. I know that's right, brother. You know? Let Rodney go on. We got something to do. We got to raise up some dead folks here, you know? That's what we have to do, is raise the dead. And those that don't want to raise, let the dead bury the dead. Mm-hmm. Because they're going to bury them anyhow, you know? If they don't get some of this knowledge about who they are and what they're doing down here, then they're going to deal with the forces that kill. And there's plenty of them out there, you know, killing. You know, it used to be a joke. You still hear people saying that, though, don't you? Girl, I ought to kill you. What you supposed to call me? That's my friend. My thinking, spoken word. Watch what you're thinking. Putting on the mind of God. There are no mistakes. There are no fears. There's no ignorance. There's no darkness. There's no poverty. In the mind of God, it's only the light, the truth, the power that we need. Okay. I would say questions, but we don't have that kind of time. Okay, my brother. Different tape? Yeah, put this on.
Well, you were comfortable.
Sorry. Side two and turn it up. Turn it up. Put everything down on the floor next to you. You can get healed with the music you're about to experience. Let it in. Very, 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 very powerful. We're not going to sound anything. We're not going to do anything. We're going to let the music do us. All I want you to do is relax. That's all.
Rewind it.
Oh, did it? Okay. All right. Okay. That's fine.
One side, too?
Yes. At various times, I will tell you to bring your attention to certain areas, like in the throat chakra. Gently bring your attention to your throat chakra inside. That's all, just your attention. And as you do, the melody, numerus, the harmony, numerus, the metrics, numerus, music, number, will find its way to that center. With music, you only need to let sacred music. It's where we're trying to get to, trying to get our Negro reincarnated souls, who are some of the finest on the planet, to wake up and realize that they bring gifts and come to the party and leave the gifts at home. So they're not bringing us the music they're supposed to be bringing us, except a few, Sweet Honey and the Rock, and a few others. We're waiting on ancient music to be brought back with these ancient musicians that keep coming down here and getting caught up in the prostitution of their own gifts. Okay. Place your thumb on your right nostril, like so. Breathe up through your left nostril and out your mouth, like so. Six times.
tension in the center of your chest, where your heart center or heart chakra is. Amahamka. Center of your chest. Place your attention right behind your Adam's apple, a round circle of golden light. Small, round, golden disc. Thank you. is dwelling with my soul together.
All is well with my soul.
Again.
All is well with my soul.
Again.
All is well with my soul. Still and know I am God together. Peace, be still and know I am God
again.
Peace, be still and know I am God
again.
Peace, be still and know I am God
again.
Peace. Be still and know I am God.
G-O-D, generator, operator, destroyer, together.
G-O-D. Generator, operator, destroyer. G-O-D. Generator, operator, destroyer.
Again.
G-O-D. Generator, operator, destroyer.
Breathe. love, peace, and wisdom. So it is. Together.
Love, peace, and wisdom. And so it is.
Okay. Sister. Thank you very much. The Tibetan bells, they open, cleanse, and stir your chakras by themselves. That's important. The music is still going on inside, where it keeps changing, doing its work. Stay in tune with the law of rhythm. That's how you change consciousness. New rhythm. Higher rhythm. Right thinking. Okay. Let me call New York and find out what the number was.
Excuse me. What voice did it like? The tape.
Sister, can you duplicate that tape for me? Okay. We're going to charge you $5 for it. Okay. It's not 8 o'clock in New York. They just gave me yesterday's number.
No, I need to ask him. How many minutes is this
taking? I don't even know. I think we're talking about a couple of hours.
You'll be able to
Get it like about 30.
It's about 25
to 30 minutes. The Tibetan
bell? Yeah, part three.
Yes. You'll be able to get them. You can order that from Looney.
Okay.
Can you? Okay. The name newly passed?
Yeah. I think so.
Okay. But she's going to order it and have it here available for you. If you all want to hang around until what? New York is on what time?
Same time.
Oh, then it's not 8 o'clock. Well, we stopped early then. Look at my little nickel and dime Mickey Mouse watch. Any questions about anything? There are several. There is the Tibetan bell. There is the singing bowl, chime, gong.
I have a thing called the Himalayan bowl. It sounds like that. They're all using these big wooden bowls.
Right. Yeah. Those are metal bowls, as far as I know. Then there's a one made out of crystal. But it's such an elaborate combination of levels of sound that they reach high levels of octaves, strike the shop. Very, very tall.
This one.
He asks you, your God within knows your spiritual need. Waiting. Is anything significant about it? What does name mean?
No more.
It seems like anything about from higher
nature.
So when you find out what it is,
I'll try and look by as close as I can.